Right. So welcome, everyone. This is the second in our fall 2023 Maryland Robotics Center seminar series. And so glad to see everyone here. I know we have a few people making it in. But I'm really excited to get to introduce you all to Professor Noah Cowan from the Department of Mechanical Engineering at Johns Hopkins University. And so Professor Cowan received his bachelor's in electrical engineering from Ohio State University, and then his master's and PhD in electrical engineering and computer science from the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. And so his lab at Johns Hopkins University certainly intersects with the types of robotics that we do here as well. And so that's why we invited him to give an excellent talk. So let's give him a big round of applause.
Well, thanks everyone for taking the time out of your day to come see my talk. I'm trained as a roboticist, and I did most of my early work in robotics, but today what I'm going to tell you about is a bit of a fish story. I'm going to tell you about some of the sensorimotor control related research that we do in weakly electric fish. So in my lab, we look at a wide variety of animal and robotic systems, but I'm going to tell you today about our animal work, starting with my work as a postdoc in Bob Full's lab studying the lowly cockroach that you probably have in your apartments and dorm rooms and may not even know it because they're so fast and they scurry off under the trash can when you walk in the room. Human locomotion and motor control with Amy Bastian, who's a neurologist and neuroscientist at Johns Hopkins. One of the main model organisms I study in my lab, which is this weakly electric fish. I'll orient you to that more a little bit later, and then work in a bunch of other animal models over the years, including this hawk moth. What you see it doing here is waggling its abdomen up and down in response to visual cues. And we looked at, when I was doing a sabbatical in Tom Daniels' lab, how that vision motor reflex helps in flight control. And so what do all these animal systems have in common? Well, they have in common that there's some neural system controlling a biomechanical plant. In this case, the plant is the animal. It's an engineering joke. How many, say, you guys are from a broad range of fields, right? So this is a robotics seminar, but how many of you had a controls course at the graduate level, let's say? How about at the undergraduate level or graduate level? Okay, great. So most of you, that's good. So I like to think about using control engineering to solve kind of an inverse robotics problem. Try to understand how the nervous system controls movement. You can read kind of a perspective piece that my former student, Madhu Madhav, who's now at the University of British Columbia, and I wrote a couple of years back in annual reviews in Control and Robotics and Autonomous Systems. This is a diagram from that system, and it's a diagram that I think kind of helps explain why control engineering is a useful model for neuroscience in particular, as opposed to maybe some other areas of biology where it may not be such a good teacher. And the reason it is, I think, a useful model is because in control engineering, we like to think about boxes with arrows that come in and arrows that go out. And we often do our control synthesis with a point of view of a flow of information through a system. But for many types of systems, that's not necessarily a good modeling paradigm. For example, when you push on an object, there's a two-way power exchange that occurs. And if you don't cut your loop in the right place, this sort of boxes and arrows sort of framework that we use in control engineering is not necessarily the right framework. But in the world of the nervous system, the brain and the musculoskeletal system and the environment are separated by kind of high gain inputs and outputs. And actually part of my way of thinking about this was actually inspired by discussions with Tim Kimmel. For example, where do you cut the loop on the motor output side really matters. If you cut the loop at forces, then it's a two-way flow of information because as a force causes something to move, the muscle length will change and then the force that muscle produces will change. And so you're getting this two-way street of information on the output. But if you cut the loop at the electrical signals to the muscles, those don't change under load. They only change because of sensory feedback that goes back to the nervous system and changes the muscle output. So it was Tim that taught me, if I cut the loop at the muscle outputs, at the EMG recordings, then I have a good place to divide between the brain and the body. And on the input side, for many types of receptors, there's a separation of the flow of information in the outside world into the nervous system. For example, as I turn my head, I see a movement of the visual scene on my retina, but I don't cause, cytons aren't coming out of my eyes causing that object in the outside world to move. There's a one-way flow of information. It's a little bit sketchy when you start talking about haptics and haptic perception, in which case this may not be the best model, but for many areas of motor control, I think it creates a nice model. So today, the specific model organism that I'll tell you the most about is the weakly electric glass knifefish. It's called Eigenmania virescens. And again, I think this is probably God's gift to people who are interested in motor control because it's got Eigen in its name. Bad engineering jokes. So these fish are extremely unusual in that they have two separate image-forming sensory modalities. They've got good teleost vision that can measure the visual world much like our eyes can. So they can see their own self-motion relative to objects, and they can see the movement of external objects just like we can. But in addition, they have electroreceptors all over the body surface that can measure the voltage across the skin, and they have an electric organ in their tail that generates a weak electric field that envelops the animal. And if there's an object that goes nearby with a different conductivity or even impedance of the surrounding fluid, I say impedance because it's an oscillatory signal, and so there can be a different capacitance that can be sensed by that oscillatory, by the change in the amplitude and the phase associated with that change in impedance. That changes the voltage at the surface of the skin, which allows the animal to see it, if you will, with its electroreceptors. And so Malcolm McIver, who's in the biomedical engineering department at Northwestern, who's studied electric fish for many years, described this as touch at a distance. It sort of measures the nearby environment through this electrosensory system. And I kind of imagine, like, if you wanted to imagine what an electric fish feels, it's like when your hair is standing on end because there's something electrically static nearby is maybe the best we can anthropomorphize. But it allows them to separately measure the environment with two different image-forming modalities. But in addition to that, if it wasn't enough that they have these two great non-contact sensors that satisfy this one-way flow of information that I was telling you about, they also have an absolutely amazing locomotor apparatus, which is this undulating ribbon fin on their ventral side. And for those who think that evolution is optimal, I want to warn you that this fish is a great example of why it's actually just a tinkerer and not sort of a global optimizer, which is that this long ribbon fin is an evolutionary adaptation of an anal fin. The anal fin on most fish sits near the back of the animal, right behind the anus. So as nature tinkered this thing and grew this fin longer and longer, this fish now poops out of its neck. Now, I don't think that's optimal. I think if nature could have rewired the hosing inside the animal, it would have chosen a different path, but it's a tinkerer, not a global optimizer. So still, it's an amazing organism that has a number of adaptations that make it quite great. One of them is that it generates this weak electric field, around 400 hertz for this species. Very low voltage, but it's the same mechanism that electric eels use. It's just that it's a much lower voltage. So they generate, electrogenesis is the same biological mechanism. It's just used for sensing rather than stunning prey. Okay? And so this is a picture from Walter Heiligenberg, who was a famous electric fish biologist, showing the schematic of what the current lines might look like going from at a given instant where the body voltage was higher than, you know, the positive anode of the electric organ was driving current out through the body and back in through the tail, and the voltage across the receptor, across the skin, would be what was measured by the electroreceptors. And if there was an object nearby that was, say, an insulator, it would distort the current lines and as well change the transdermal potential that the electric sensors were picking up. And then here is that ribbon fin. This is a video one of the students in my lab took. And you can see that it has this incredible ribbon fin with these inward counter-propagating waves that actually create forces. I'll show that a bit more in a minute. The fish is able to adjust how much of the fin is traveling one way versus the other in order to adjust the fore aft forces that are produced by the animal. But from a control engineering point of view, the thing that's best about these organisms is that when you put them into a tank with a tube, they swim in it and try to hide. And as a result, you can do things like what my colleague Eric Fortune is doing right now, moving the tube back and forth, and the fish is doing its darndest to try to stay in that tube. And when I see this video, over and over again, it looks to me that that fish is attached to the tube by a spring and a damper, but there's nothing mechanically attaching that fish to the tube. It's all neural feedback control. The fish is sensing the relative motion and adjusting the commands to its ribbon fin in order to stay inside the tube. And so when I went to Eric Fortune's lab back in like 2004, he was my next door neighbor, so that's how I met him. And I found out that he studied electric fish, and I went to his lab, and he had an old-fashioned pen plotter flipped upside down with a tube at the end, hooked up to a function generator, and he was doing some biology experiments that I still don't to this day know what he was doing, because he stopped doing them that day, because it was hooked up to a function generator, and I said, hey, can we put in sine waves and get a Bode plot of the fish? He didn't know what a Bode plot was, but he didn't know what a frequency response was, because he was a well-trained neuroscientist. So we spent 4.5 hours collecting Bode plot data of the electric fish that became the pilot data for our first grant. So they're really an easy system to sort of elicit this kind of behavior and to do the kind of system ID and modeling and control modeling that we do. So here's a more fancy version of the same thing. Now instead of Eric's arm was getting tired, so we built a motor that would move the tube back and forth. And we're just tracking in red the movement of the what we call the refuge, which is the hiding place for the fish, and tracking in blue the position of the fish. And while you can see a little bit of drift, because the fish doesn't always care exactly where in the tube it is, you see a nice sinusoidal response of the fish in response to the tube movement. Meanwhile, if we zoom in, and this is a little bit of a difficult video to see, but if we zoom in and look at the ribbon fin, that's the whole fish there, and we're going to box in, and this zoomed in part is that point on the ribbon fin. Turns out that the ribbon fin, which is kind of like my fingers, it's actuated by a bunch of mechanically independent muscles that allow it to make these traveling waves, but that are actually driven by timing differences to the muscles along the body, so it can generate these inward propagating waves. And if it wants to, say, swim that way, it would recruit more of the fin to go one way to generate an imbalance of the force and cause it to swim off to this direction. Or if it wants to swim the other way, it would recruit more of the fin going that direction. And it turns a very nonlinear problem of the hydrodynamic forces that are generated by these traveling waves into an incredibly linear problem of just trimming the difference of two nonlinearities. Okay? And so we can... The fish is shown stationary because we've actually, we're moving the video. You can actually see the fish is actually moving, but we're sort of centering the fish on the image. And we're zooming in and looking at the nodal point going back and forth while we do sinusoidal oscillations to the tube. And the fish's velocity, which is indicated by that arrow on the right there, the Y dot, is changing as well. And now we can do system ID to understand the relationship between the movement of that nodal position where the two inward waves meet and the movement of the fish. And so here's what that looks like when we plot it as data. On the x-axis is time, and on the y-axis is rostral caudal body position, so fore aft body position. And what we're doing is we're tracking the peaks and troughs of the fin over time as the wave travels from tail to head and head to tail. And where the two inward waves meet is what we call the nodal point. And as we move the tube back and forth, making the fish swim back and forth, we see that nodal point move back and forth. And so if we do that a bunch of times, we get a bunch of traces for what we're calling U of T, the control input to the fish. One stage removed from the muscle EMGs, and we talk about in some of our papers why we think the nodal position is a good surrogate for EMGs in this case. And then we can plot the fish's motion relative to the tube, and then begin to do system identification to figure out what's the plant and what's the controller. And so over many years, we've done a whole bunch of papers examining this system, which you can check out on our website if you're interested. But the upshot of all that is kind of interesting on the one hand, but maybe as a control engineer and roboticist, kind of boring, which is that the plant ends up being pretty well modeled by mx double dot plus bx dot equals ku, so second order mass and damper system with a force input. And then the control system, there's a number of interesting things about it, but depending on whether we're looking at the sort of a linear approximation of the control or some really interesting nonlinearities in the control, like the fact that it can track pure sinusoidal references much better than it can track noisy signals, probably based on something that looks like an internal model principle controller, but an adaptive one, and hence it's nonlinear. We've done some recent modeling work on that. So so let's go back to, so as I was saying, a lot of the upshot of that work, you know, it's pretty great when you can get a paper in PNAS that says that you've modeled a system as a second order mechanical system, but there's a lot that goes into why the ribbon fin ends up collapsing in that way. In fact, I was talking to one of your colleagues today that was pointing out what a beautiful thing is that this kind of linear modeling can work so well when it's the output of the confluence of so many nonlinear components. And so this is an example of where when you're doing something like stabilizing an equilibrium, near that equilibrium, things can look quite linear, right? And give us a lot of insight. So a lot of what we do in control engineering, usually what we do in control engineering is we start with a system that we want to control, and we start to think, how do we design algorithms to control that? And so if we take the neuroscience perspective, this is how I started my career in this area, was trying to understand the physics of movement and trying to figure out how that informs the control algorithm. And so I mentioned some examples of that. But the first little short vignette that I want to tell you about today is related, which is how does the animal learn a new controller when it's faced with a change in what those locomotor dynamics are, right? So if we could somehow change the dynamics of the fish, I don't know, for example, putting it in molasses instead of water, or changing the strength of the signals that the muscle commands were generating and things like that, then we could look to see an important nonlinearity in the fish controller, which is, does it adapt its internal control system, and what features of that, what are the consequences of that adaptation? Does it try to maintain stability or improve other aspects of performance? Does it favor robustness or optimality? And then, is it really learning, or is it just quickly adjusting on the fly in kind of a memoryless way? Or if we were to change the stimulus abruptly, would it show some residual history that it actually learned and changed its controller, and now it has to readapt back to a baseline? So those are the questions that we addressed with this. But instead of doing what would maybe seem more natural of changing the locomotor mechanics, what we did was we actually closed a feedback loop around the animal. I guess this was a little bit also of a big picture salesmanship slide to say that when we're doing this, the ideal thing would be to perturb and measure in as many places in this loop as we can. As a biologist, we're often interested in how does a subcomponent work, but as a control engineer, I don't understand that unless I can understand how it fits into the whole closed loop picture. And so you both need to understand what biologists call mechanism, which is like, how does a neuron convey information from one place to another? That's a mechanism. But another person might say, no, that's not a mechanism. How does the ion channels work? No, that's not the mechanism. How does the physics of the ions work? You know, so one person's mechanism is another person's phenomenon. For me, the mechanism of a fly ball governor isn't the fact that when it spins around, the balls go up. It's that it's a closed loop feedback controller that's designed to regulate something that's important. And it was a very clever way of getting that to happen, but you can imagine doing that many other ways. In fact, we don't usually use fly ball governors anymore. We use electronic control systems, but they serve the same purpose as the fly ball governor. So I don't care so much about the low level implementation, except insofar as some constraint about how it's implemented informs my understanding. I'm really interested in the closed loop dynamics. So for this project, we didn't change the locomotor dynamics. We took this refuge tracking system, which I'll show a little video of. Here's the fish moving back and forth. In response to the movement of the refuge traces in red and the fish's traces in blue as a function of time. And again, it's a little hard to see in some of these videos. This is infrared illumination. You might be able to see the ribbon fin if you're sitting in the front, but the fish is just long, slender body that's sort of swimming back and forth to stay inside the tube. And so instead of changing the locomotor mechanics, what we did was we changed the consequence of the fish's movement. So the idea is, as the fish swims, normally, its experience is that if a fish swims forward 1 centimeter, it experiences a retrograde movement of the environment by 1 centimeter, like a natural, what biologists call reafferent feedback. Reafferent means that it's, I don't know why they use that word, but afference is like sensing, and reafference is apparently sensing of your own movement. So that's a term in biology. But the reafferent feedback is a one-to-one sort of a thing. What if we could, like, measure the fish's position in real time, as I almost fall down, measure the fish's position in real time, feed it back through some nonlinear or linear dynamics, we use linear dynamics, but feed it back through some dynamics, and use that to control the tube. So now that when the fish swims forward, what it experiences isn't just exactly one-to-one retrograde motion, but something else. And the particular dynamical system that we chose to feed back through was a high-pass filter, which would have the effect of, say the gain was K of that high-pass filter was 1. If the fish moved rapidly, the tube would just move right with the fish. And then as the fish stopped, it would decay back to 0, right? So now the fish has to understand that in order to move in the tube, the way it's going to perceive that is going to be different. And it turns out if we increase the gain K sufficiently high, then according to some simple modeling, we should be able to destabilize the fish if it doesn't adapt its controller. And so that was the question that we set out to do. We took, this is now a block diagram for that. Again, reafferent feedback is the feedback caused by the animal's movement. And you can think about this other loop as an artificial reafferent feedback, where we're going to now move the tube in response to the fish's movement. Okay? And we're going to adjust this gain K as we do. And here's the basic protocol. We're going to increase the gain over time. And this is one of those things where I'm showing you the final outcome, but this took probably a couple of years of pilot experiments to try to figure out the right way to run this protocol until we finally came up with a protocol where we got meaningful and interpretable results. We slowly, over the course of about a half an hour, keep sort of, we're like boiling the frog. We keep turning up the gain of this feedback, and the fish never experiences a condition where the feedback is turned off until the very end. And then during that time, we'll turn up the gain a little bit, and then we'll send a sum of signs signal to the tube, in addition to the feedback that's coming back to the tube, so that we can do an assay and figure out what the control system looks like at that moment. Then we'll turn up the gain a little bit more and do another system ID experiment. And then we'll turn up the gain a little bit more and do another system ID experiment. Do that for a half an hour. Meantime, if the fish is doing its job, then it should be slowly learning that the consequences of its own movement are changing, and it should tweak its controller. That was the hypothesis. And so one hypothesis is the fish is really dumb and doesn't know what's going on, and it just keeps its controller constant. And I'm schematizing the controller as like a parameter, right? And the red line just stays constant, and the fish just, eventually we make the thing unstable and the fish crashes out of the tube or something, right? Another hypothesis is that as we turn it up, the fish is somehow changing its controller, but as soon as we turn off the external gain of this artificial feedback, the fish goes right back to its baseline. So somehow it's changing its controller, but it's not like retaining it. It's not like a learned. So there's an idea in motor control research that when you, if any of you wear strongly correcting glasses, you might know that when you take off your glasses, things are a little bit distorted. And I know as now that I wear readers, I'm a juggler also. I never juggle with my readers on because the balls don't quite land in the right spot in my visual field when I do that, until I calibrate, right? I can calibrate, but there's a calibration that you have to go through, and that takes some time to wash out. And so our third hypothesis, which was really our main hypothesis, but we, of course, were evaluated with respect to these other two ideas, is that it actually retains, when you turn off the external feedback, it actually retains that learned controller for a while until it eventually washes back out to the baseline controller that it had before we started the experiment. So the first thing is, did the fish learn to adjust its controller? And so again, here's the feedback diagram. First thing we do is we do a stimulus, S of T, which is a movement of the tube that's a pseudo-random stimulus. And then we fit the dynamics between S of T and Y of T. And we figure out what the Bode plot of that is. And then we turn up the gain K higher and higher, and we keep doing that over and over. But what I'm going to plot is just the Bode plot from S of T to Y of T, the frequency response function of that part of this diagram. Okay? And what we found is that as we cranked up the gain, the fish sensory motor transformation, which includes its own internal reafferent feedback loop, but the fish sensory motor transform is indeed changing, and changing quite a bit in its frequency response. So on the x-axis here is frequency, and on the y-axis of the top plot is the gain of the sensory motor transform of the fish. And again, the sensory motor transform including the controller, the plant, and its own natural reafferent feedback. Okay, we could open it up further and get the inside, but that doesn't matter. We're just looking at the part that of the fish. Not this, this transfer function does not, transfer function estimate does not include our artificial feedback at the point. And so it's actually changing. It's becoming more phase leading and this sort of higher peak at high frequencies. And so we see this consistent trend. This is for one fish. And so what we did in order to sort of test whether this was general is we looked at a specific frequency in for phase and a specific frequency in gain and plot across all of our fish as we increase the feedback gain now. Do we see a change in the phase at this frequency and a change in the gain at this frequency as a function of this increased feedback? And in all fish, except I think one of them was not statistically significant, had a positive trend, but was not not statistically different than zero. So the fish do adjust their controller. Then what we looked at was whether or not the fish are able to, when they do this, does it improve any measure of robustness? And I think, actually, in the interest of time, this is the first time I've incorporated this part in my talk, I'm going to skip over the how we did that and just say that we did that. And what we found is that the fish improved its phase margin. If you're familiar with that from control engineering, the fish improved its phase margin by modifying its controller in this way. And again, our control, our feedback was designed to eventually drive that phase margin to zero to make the system unstable. And adding that phase lead that you saw is providing some robustness against that that perturbation. It also we also found that, and I'm not going to talk about this either, the details of, but you can check it out in our bioarchive paper, that it improves the robustness to disturbances that might happen from turbulence in the flow or motor errors like muscle variation, right? Variations to the muscle commands. So variations that would cause change in force, this adjustment in the controller improved the what's called the Bode sensitivity, if you've seen that in one of your courses. So, and then the last part of this is, did the fish remember this controller when we switched back off the experiment? And so again, to remind you the paradigm, we increase the control for 30 minutes, and then at what I'm going to call t equals zero, we turn off the external artificial feedback. So now it's just a fish swimming in a tube again. And then we're going to see, then we're going to do system ID experiments right away, and then wait a couple minutes and do it again, and then wait a couple minutes and do it again, and see if the controller slowly returns back to its baseline control. And what we found, this is one example, what we found is that immediately after, the controller still has an elevated gain and a bit of a phase lead. And then as we wait longer and longer for this one animal, we see the phase returning to baseline, and the baseline and one day after are about the same. You can see them there, they're about the same. So after about after about 15 minutes, it pretty much had returned to baseline. And then when we came back in and tested the fish the next day, it was still back at baseline. So, and we looked at that across all of our animals, and we had to do some kind of bootstrapping-based statistical analysis, but we see that the return to baseline stays statistically above baseline for a while before it eventually settles out to the baseline condition. So it does kind of remember it in what is thought to be like a cerebellar adaptation kind of a way, the same adaptation that you would do if I took a mouse and I rotated it 45 degrees and made you use it that way, it would take you, you know, 5 or 10 minutes to get used to that. And if I rotate it back, it would take you 5 or 10 minutes to unlearn that. That's thought to be mediated in part by the cerebellum, and this has the hallmarks of that kind of cerebellar learning. So we don't know if it's mediated by the cerebellum in the fish, but it is similar in that in terms of its temporal dynamics. So in summary, the fish did learn their controller, and it enhanced stability robustness. It rejected, when they did it, it helped improve the rejection of low-frequency disturbances, and it retained the controller for some time until it washed out to baseline. And so that was really taking a kind of like standard engineering
approach of like, how do I think about how the closed loop dynamics affects what the controller is doing? We didn't modify the plant, we modified it by adding this external feedback, but it's sort of in the same vein as how I sort of grew up thinking about control engineering. I'm changing the dynamics, the controller should change to adapt to it. We certainly think about sensing in engineering, but actually, for anybody who's had like a linear systems course, you know that you develop this idea of a state estimator or a Kalman filter. And one of the normal things that we learn in our everyday engineering application is that you just have to put enough sensing on the system in order to be able to get a good state estimate. And once you can get a good state estimate, then you've kind of separated the problem of state estimation and control. Now, in reality, of course, you have to think about how the sensors are shaping noise, and you need to add more sensing to reduce your variability and things like that. But certainly from the, once you're given a set of sensors, you separate the problem of state estimation from the problem of control in most engineering design-based courses. For example, a linear quadratic Gaussian controller is an optimal state estimator, namely a Kalman filter, together with the linear quadratic regulator, where you just substitute in the state estimate as if it's the real state, right? And that's kind of the mindset that I grew up thinking about control engineering. I remember thinking what an amazing thing the separation principle was. But maybe animals don't work that way. Maybe there's something about their sensory receptors that caused them to actually modify their motor behavior, not just to achieve a task, but to go out and sense. So for example, if I ask you to tell me how heavy this water bottle was, you wouldn't just like this. You'd sort of you'd do something with your motor system to get a better sense of what that force felt like in your hand. If I said, is it rough or smooth, you would move your hand across its surface so that you would excite the very specific receptors in the surface of your skin. Yes?
This is a comment. The separation principle almost never holds. It's the linear case, linear quadratic case is unique.
Of course. No, that's true. You're absolutely correct. But we still apply it as if it holds.
No, I understand.
Yeah. So I agree. It almost never holds. It doesn't hold for nonlinear systems. It doesn't even hold for linear systems with proportional noise. Like it just does. But we treat it like it's the right way to do it because that's the paradigm that we know how to do. And the question is, are there heuristics that you might apply that could be much better in certain circumstances? Certainly, there's many people that know that there's many cases where the separation principle doesn't apply and how to solve it formally. And so I'm not saying that separation principle is always used and is thought to be hold for everything. I'm just saying that as a student of controls, that's how I learned the first best thing to try, right? But your point is extremely well taken. I told you I was scared that he was in the front row.
He called it out beforehand. He said, I don't know about giving this talk with you in the front row.
But there's something unique that animals do, which is that all of their sensors are kind of tuned differently. And so when you want to get information, you excite your motor system in a way that's specific to the sensory information that you want to get. If I want to know if it's cold, I press my hand on it to allow thermal conductivity to occur to get to the receptors that are good at measuring temperature. And the time constants of those is different than the ones that measure friction, high-frequency vibrations that are good for texture determination. So each one of these things is what are called in the biology literature active sensing. It's basically the idea that you're using self-generated energy to get information from the environment. And, you know, I saw a really beautiful talk by Stefano Soato many years ago who was talking about very similar ideas, but from a point of view of robot motion planning and control. And probably the most salient version of that are things like occlusions. Like if I want to know what's behind, or if I need to know in order to do a task what's behind this monitor, I have to do a large active sensing maneuver in order to see that, right? And so that's an example of active sensing. And so I guess I'll kind of skip past this and just give a really compelling example of why our sensory receptors and the way information is processed in our nervous system may lead to the need for active sensing in many organisms. So what I want you to do is try your best to fixate on the plus sign in this image. I'm going to do it too so that I know the time constant. And don't move your eyes off the plus sign. And if it works for you, the purple should almost disappear. But as soon as you look around at it again, it'll reappear. Okay? How many people did that work for? Okay, great. Most of you. So that's called perceptual fading. And that can be a lower level sensory periphery problem, and but it can also be a higher level neural processing, I don't want to say problem, but feature. So at different stages of neural processing, you can get this perceptual fading. We've all had the experience where we're sitting in a office and all of a sudden the HVAC system turns off and you realize how loud it had been, right? Because your mind had adapted to the persistent stimulus. And so if you adapt to persistent stimuli, that makes you very good potentially at detecting change in those stimuli, but not very good at measuring the DC value of a stimulus. When we jump into a pool, it feels really cold at first, and then it feels fine. Like, what temperature is the water? I don't know. It's relative to my skin that matters. And if I put my, but if I put my hand in two pots of water that are like a degree apart, I could tell which one was cooler. But I'd have no idea what the absolute temperature was within 10 degrees, right? Unless I don't know. I can't tell. But I know if it's comfortable or not, or I know if one's a little cooler than the other or not. So in electric fish, there's good evidence that their electroreceptors are high pass in nature. So a high-pass filter is one that blocks DC. And so I like to think about this talk, this part of the talk, is the goal of the fish is to maintain a DC value, a position, inside of a tube. Because it wants to hide. Fish hide in the natural environment. My colleague Aaron Fortune goes out in the Amazon River Basin to Ecuador and to Brazil and other places and measures these fish in the wild. And he often finds them hiding in logs and hiding in root and reed grasses and so forth, to avoid predation. And in the lab, they're avoiding being eaten by the graduate student. So they swim into the tube and they hide. And they like to hold that DC position. But they're doing so with sensors that are only good at measuring in AC. And so I'm going to show you two videos. Again, let me orient you because these videos are hard to tell what's going on. The fish is this long, slender thing. In one case, the ambient, the visible light is on. In the other case, it's off. And in both cases, they're illuminated with infrared so that we, the experimenters, can see it. So the videos look kind of similar, even though the lights are on versus off. And then what you're going to see is the tube moving back and forth. And this is a short time window of that occurring. And the red curve, again, is the trajectory of the refuge. And the blue curve is the trajectory of the fish. And you'll see this remarkable behavior when the lights turn off in the top video. It's a little bit more than the time window that's shown there. As you see, it's already gone back two or three times. Light should turn off here. Now the fish begins doing this very large scale back and forth movements much more prevalently. And then conversely, when the lights are off and we turn them on, you know, on average, it's still following the tube when the lights are off, but it's with this superimposed movement. And turn on the lights, and the fish starts to follow it quite steadily. I do want to point your attention to the fact that there is some little active sensing movement going on there, which we'll come back to a little bit later. This particular clip didn't have much of it, but a few years ago, I was trying to think up what would be the simplest model of a control system that would require active sensing. So how simple could I make a system that I would not possibly be able to control it if I didn't violate the separation design principle, even if it's not a principle in terms of the mathematics, the separation design paradigm. If I didn't violate that paradigm, I would not be able to control it to a position inside to a position, let's say. And so the way the model was, I've got a simplified sensory scene, and I'm just going to say one receptor on the body of the fish, and that receptor, as it moves across the scene, will get like zeros and then ones and then zeros and then ones as it walk, you know, in a sinusoidal pattern, use this very simplified plant that was developed by, I'm highlighting my most recent student who worked on this, actually postdoc, Ismail Uyunik. Take this very simplified plant, which I said looks like a mass damper with a force on the side, which if you put it in the state space, looks like this. Quickly checking the math. And then the sensor receptor is, it gets a value between 0 and 1 as the sensor receptor moves back and forth, but we're going to do one more thing, which is we're going to take the time derivative of that signal as the simplest high-pass filter, right? So this is the smallest dimensional, simplest system. It's a linear system with a nonlinear output. And it turns out if you linearize that system around any equilibrium point, which because there's no spring, then the equilibrium points are kind of any position can be an equilibrium point, you end up with a system that's unobservable, meaning you can't use the separation design paradigm. I'm just going to call it from now on rather than the principle. Is that better? So there's a very simple result in a little archive paper that we collaborated with Eduardo Sontag on, which is that this is that same model, but I just used slightly different variables. There exists no dynamic feedback that will stabilize this system to the origin. So it's not just a linear design problem, it's a nonlinear design problem. You can't make the origin a stable equilibrium through feedback for that system. Meaning that in order to control it to a position, you really have to move a little bit. You can't stabilize the equilibrium. And then Eduardo solved the flip side of that, which is that as long as the scene is aperiodic, and I know I showed like a sine wave grating, which is periodic, which is just means that I only know where I am up to the peaks and troughs of that sine wave, but he showed that as long as the scene is aperiodic, you can write a nonlinear observer that's global, but you just have to have a little exciting input in order to do that. So you need some kind of persistently exciting input to make your observer. So those are technicalities. You can check out the archive paper. But now we have this problem. The fish has a task of staying inside the tube to avoid getting eaten by the graduate student, but it has this problem that it can't estimate where it is in the tube unless it moves a little bit. And so we have the problem of task level control sort of competing with the active sensing requirement that we now know would exist, at least in our simplified model. And so we've got a bunch of papers. Actually, most of the early part of the electric fish work was in trying to figure out things about that task level controller, and we've done a little bit of work on the active sensing before this. But then Debajoti Biswas, postdoc in my lab, came along to look at this from a different point of view. So the simple idea is that as animals move, they have to make exploratory movements in order to gain information, and then exploitative movements in order to do the task. And so it really fits in this kind of explore versus exploit framework. And so I'm just going to jump in and show this video here of, again, this is similar to the video that I showed earlier, but now here's with the lights turned on. And occasionally you see these rapid movements, just like we saw in the dark. This is a little bit longer time. This is sped up by quite a factor, played back at a factor of four. But in the dark, we see them much more often. But it's not all the time. You see flat periods as well. And so what we found by looking more carefully at a much broader data set is that when you turn down the lights, it's not that you turn on the active sensing, it's that you make it happen more frequently, right? So what could be going on there? So if we think about, here's the position and velocity for a lights on trial, and if we think about problems where you're basically maintaining near zero velocity as kind of the low-level control to keep you in the tube, punctuated by large-scale movements that are active sensing oriented, then you could think about this as kind of an explore versus exploit kind of paradigm. And in the dark, it's the same thing. It's just that the explore motions are happening more frequently. And so if its goal is to remain within the refuge, it could do just small corrective movements with constant exploration, but we don't think that's what's happening. We think what the animals are doing is switching on and off this exploration. And so now let's go back to the same kind of data, but now I'm going to show 7 to 10 trials, depending on the condition, for 40 seconds, just the velocity, and then plot the velocities over each other multiple times, and then take a histogram of those velocities. But we're going to plot the histogram in a log probability scale. So you know a Gaussian looks like e to the minus x squared, so when you plot it on a log scale, it'll just look like a quadratic. And you can see that's really not quadratic. You get this sharp peak at the center. And we talk about this as kind of like a broad shouldered distribution. And so when you fit a Gaussian, which is the dashed line here, the dashed pink line, very, very much not a good fit. But if you include, say, and I'm really that picky about the particular heuristic fit that we use, but we use something called a Gaussian mixture model, and you can get a much better fit of the data that captures this key characteristic of this high center of the mean. Right? High center of the distribution near the mean.
And so, and the key thing is that the way we think about this, and we've modeled this a number of different ways, is that there's these exploratory movements and these exploitative movements. Exploratory movements being these higher velocity movements of the fish swimming back, interdigitated with periods of quiescent control where it's sitting and maintaining its position. And the thing that threw me off the most is that I always thought about when you deprive the organism of sensing, it should increase its active sensing, and active sensing is fundamentally driven by a nonlinearity. So shouldn't I expect, naively, the system to become more non-Gaussian in the dark? Because it's doing more active sensing, and active sensing is nonlinear, and when you filter Gaussians through nonlinear things, you're likely to get more non-Gaussian things. This was my intuition. It's exactly the opposite, actually, which is that in the light, we see a much higher kurtosis, which is you can use it as a measure of the non-normality. A kurtosis of 3 is a normal distribution. And in the dark, things are starting to look more Gaussian, not less Gaussian. Now, just to fast forward, the intuition there is if you make it completely asensory, it's active sensing all the time, and the active sensing movements look Gaussian, so it starts to look like a Gaussian. So basically, by turning up the sensory noise or turning down the sensory salience, as we call it, then you actually just start active sensing all the time, and active sensing looks largely like a Gaussian distribution. So that's why my intuition was like completely 180 degrees from reality. Yep.
Maybe you said this, but with the light-dark conditions and the two sensing modalities between the electric sense and the visual sense, I'm a little confused. So are you implying that the fish also uses vision for active sensing?
Yes, thank you.
Or is it that the electric sense requires the relative movement in order to perceive anything in that modality?
Great question. So there's multiple layers of that question, and I should have said this. So you're right. We're taking an animal that can see with two different sensory modalities, vision and electrosense. I said see, but sense with two different sensory modalities. And we're removing one of the senses, or at least in this case, we're actually pretty much completely eliminating vision and making the fish rely more on electrosense, and then it shows more active sensing. So it's a bit of a confusing question about what's exactly happening. So we're definitely decreasing the sensory salience overall in the sense that it had two sensors that were both giving it the same information. Now it only has one. The second issue is that it turns out the fish can probably move their eyes a little bit, so they can do a little active sensing that we're not picking up with our video. And so that's also another confound. So let me come back to that, but just to say that for simplicity now, and I'm going to get to the multiple sensor modality in just one or two slides, just think about it as I'm overall turning down the salience. It's a bit of a cheat, but your question is really well taken, and it's more complicated than that because there's multiple modalities. Hang on for 1 second on that. So we see this increase in kurtosis, which I tried to give some intuition for, and basically what we think is happening is that when you turn up the sensory salience, you spend more time doing the slow corrective movements and less time doing the exploratory movements, the slow exploitative movements and less time doing the exploitative. And so I think I'll kind of skip through a little bit some of the, we did three different types of models, hidden Markov models and so forth, beyond just doing this velocity threshold, but that's kind of a data analysis question. So you can check it out in our paper. But in answer to your question, luckily for us, Malcolm McIver's lab took a fish that was only in the dark, relying only on electrosense, and then added a jamming signal to the electricity. So it only had one modality for sensing, and they decreased its reliability by adding a jamming signal. And we reanalyzed their data, and I'll just jump to the key slide. We reanalyzed their data, and when it didn't have the jamming signal on, it had a higher kurtosis than when we jammed for their data set. So now we're not having the confusing confound of multiple modalities. We're just taking one modality and making it more or less reliable. And we see the same trend.
But there's one other thing that I'm confused about with the electric sense, which is that, is it correct that it actually doesn't perceive anything in a static configuration?
Well, that's what the theory is roughly based on. I would say that it's fairly certain that it senses it better when there's movement. I would not go so far as to say it can't sense it at all. And so there's a softer version of this theory which just says, well, maybe it's observable,
but the observability improves when you add active sensing. So I wouldn't want to go so far on a limb as to say it completely perceptually fades if it doesn't move, but it almost certainly perceives it much better when it does move. And the same principle would apply, because you would still have less uncertainty if you add the movement about your position. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess the other wrinkle is that with the light on condition, the active sensing that you perceive could be the electric sense, or it could actually be the visual sense, trying to perceive like the ends of the tube or something like that.
Yeah, and I think it's probably a mix. And so that's why it was important to do two things. One is to look at other examples, like with different sensory modalities. In this case, we actually had the same species, but with just electrosense, to see if we see the same trend. And also to look at a model, which I'll talk about really briefly as well. So in the basic story from our fish and from Malcolm McIver's study, the same fish, is that when you increase the salience of the signal, you see these increases in the non-normality, and you always see this kind of heavy-tailed or broad-shouldered distribution, technically, not heavy-tailed. I didn't talk about this, but how often you switch decreases when you increase the sensory salience. So what about other organisms? So this was the thing that I found maybe most remarkable about what Devjoti did. He went to many different groups. I think we got some data from Tim as well on postural balance. Went to many different papers on many different organisms and looked at what their velocity distribution looked like as a function of sensory salience. And for many of the organisms, we had, for anything that had a star, we had data sets where the authors had modified the sensory salience so we could look at the relative change of the velocity distributions. But for many of the other ones, we just looked at one example data set. And so those are just the common names of those organisms. He's now looked at a bunch of others. He's looked at some plants, for example, doing phototaxis, and finding the same thing. The thing that I can only emphasize, and you have to believe me, is that we have not yet found a counterexample to any of these ideas. Every data point that we've collected and analyzed has shown the same trend. And you just have to believe me. I don't know you can't look at my computer and make sure I'm not lying, but we can't find counterexamples to this, which would actually be helpful, because when everything always agrees, it's a little bit scary. So we looked at Tim's lab's data on medial lateral postural sway and found evidence of this broad shoulder velocity distribution. We looked at hummingbirds feeding from a flower, where we looked at the end of the proboscis as it was going in the nectary, and we see evidence of this type of non-Gaussian distribution. And we just see this for a wide range of organisms in a wide range of tasks, which obviously I can't go into in any detail. But in really neat cases like the cockroach antenna, where they clip the length of the antenna from its natural length of 4 centimeters down to 1 centimeter, we see a decrease in the kurtosis. And as soon as you get down to an almost fully ablated antenna, it's using its antenna for olfaction, we see it's basically just casting back and forth in a Gaussian distribution because it doesn't know what the heck's going on. I mean, that's me anthropomorphizing, obviously. So I'm almost done. I know I'm a little bit over time. So we see these similar broad shoulder distributions of movement velocities and similar salience across taxa. And I'll just end by pointing out that Devjoti went and compared the energetics and the tracking performance of a control scheme. It's a heuristic that uses an extended Kalman filter, but it adds some active sensing movements when the uncertainty of the Kalman filter reaches a certain threshold. You turn on the active sensing movements until your uncertainty decreases to a certain threshold, then you turn them off and your uncertainty grows. And if you just do that very simple heuristic, it significantly outperformed both energetically and in tracking performance a persistent excitation scheme where you inject energy all the time. So I think with that, I will just give some acknowledgments. Got lots of really good data from several colleagues in the field, as well as a lot of really good feedback. You can check out our papers on the active sensing and the observability online. I would ask that it's right now, we did get our
mode switching paper accepted at Nature Machine Intelligence, so this is embargoed at least for a few weeks. The earlier work that I showed on sensorimotor adaptation to the destabilizing dynamics was done by my PhD student Yu Yang and a master student that was in a lab. Oh, that says WJD Biswas. That's not WJD Biswas. That's Dominic Yared. That was a cut and paste error. Dominic Yared. With that, I'd be happy to take any questions.
All right. Well, that was a lot of great information. I learned a lot in a really short amount of time. So one could say that was an efficient learning experience. Yes. We're going there. All right. Derek, go for it.
I don't know if this is a counterexample, but it seemed like in those distributions, the task was zero velocity and the sensing was non-zero, I think.
Absolutely, yeah.
But we study, in one of my projects, we study kick-glide behavior in fish, mm-hmm. which is hypothesized to be a separation of sensing and actuation in the following way, that when you glide, you're maximizing your sensory perception. When you kick, you're actuating, you flap your tail. Mm-hmm. And so that's a sort of, it's not a counterexample, but it's an inversion because the task, let's say, is to orient and swim towards something, mm-hmm. right? But that requires, if you think about the angle or the angular rate, let's say, that requires angular rotation, the task, but the sensing requires zero angular rate. So it's the reverse of the examples that you were giving.
I would love to sit and think through, like, if you have good models for that, how you would actually add the sensing and the sensing uncertainty. Because you're right, a tremendous limitation of this is that I've only sort of figured out how to think about things like standing still. Right? And if you now, everybody's going to be watching people in the grocery store, and you're going to see them standing still every now and then, and they're going to go like this. Right? And that I know how to think about a little bit, but things like that I don't know how to think about. So
just the reverse. So another example would be.
I wonder how the distribution of kick and glide changes as a function of the salience of the signal, and could we predict that with a model like this?
Yeah. It would be. I mean, another example it would be if you're walking in the woods and you hear something. The task is a non-zero velocity walk forward, but to listen to observe, you have to stop because your feet make noise or something like that.
Yeah,
it's just an aversion.
Absolutely.
The distribution would probably look different. It would probably
I should say, in the context of goal-seeking zero-velocity tasks,
yes.
we found that's only, because that's the only ones we analyzed.
Exactly.
But there's neat evidence, actually, from, I forget the guy's name at UBC, that the proprioceptors fade, and so it seems that the data that Tim has, where the postural sway has this kind of broad shoulders, might be because it's helping prevent that. You know, this is our belief based on the evidence, but I want somebody like him to shoot it down or find a counterexample, or you to tell me that it doesn't work in this case because it's a new idea.
So we're a bit out of time, so we're going to wrap up there. So one more round of applause for our speaker.